الرحمن الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء وخاتم المرسلين سيدنا ونبينا بالقاسم محمد ولأهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين واللانة الدائمة الباقية لأعدائهم من الآن إلى قيام يوم الدين أما بعد we really don't have much time. This is the last talk that I'll be having with you in the month of Ramadan. The next few nights we are having competition of Quran recitation and memorization. And then we'll end with, you know, towards the middle of the week, A'mal of Eid al-Fitr, which night we'll let you know later on. Unless you were there in the moon sighting seminar last night, maybe you can figure that out. Predicting the time restraint. I talked about the Quran yesterday, and I would like to share with you something more lighter, keeping with the time. Something which is very common we hear sometimes on the internet, especially among the Sunnis, this issue of bid'ah and haram comes up again and again. And that is to do with the usage of the numerical values of the Arabic alphabets. Among the Arabs, there is a system known as Abjad. Abjad, Hawaz, Hutti, Kaliman, which means that each Arabic alphabet has been given a numerical value. If you look at the, do we have the first slide, you will see this in many places, it's easily available, that each Arabic number has been given a value. However, it doesn't go by the sequence, it's not Alif, Ba, Ta, Sa. No, it is Abjad, Hawaz, you know, Alif, Ba, Jim, Dal, He, Wa, Za. This is how it goes. And, you know, this is used, you know, in different ways. For example, we see the usage of the number 786, especially among the Muslims who are from the South Asian background. And we say this stands for Bismillah Rahman Rahim. What does it mean? Actually, it is the equivalent of the numerical value of the alphabets in Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. If we go to the second slide, this is what you will see if we have the right fonts there. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Each of these alphabets, if you look at the chart above it and give a number to it, and if you calculate it, the total will be 786. Now, sometimes I see in internet, you know, especially among the Sunnis, they have a discussion, oh, this is bid'ah, this is haram, you should not do it. It is a holy number of the Hindus, it's coming from the Hindu origin. There's nothing like that. There was a reason why the Muslims in South Asia started this system. And it has a shari basis to it, actually. It might be bid'ah, but it is bid'atun hasana. As I mentioned last night, that there is a bid'ah, Sayyi'ah and bid'ah hasana. You see, in the old days, when you, even now, it is very common when you write a letter to somebody, a fellow Muslim, you would like to start with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. But we know for sure that people do not necessarily file their letters. You know, after a few days or weeks, it's going to go into garbage. And so the concern was, you know, if I write Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, beginning of my letter, you know, there is chances that this will be thrown. And the concern for sanctity of the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala basically brought up this, you know, solution. Instead of writing the words from the ayat, from the Quran, instead of writing Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, you just use the numerical number which is equivalent of the numbers of Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So it became a code for the people. So then you can easily write, even if it's thrown, it's not the name, proper name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even in the Farsi culture, if you look at especially the Allamah, when they write the letters to one another, they do not necessarily write Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. They would say, Bismihi ta'ala. In the name of Him, the Almighty. They would refrain from you putting the word Allah there because there is a chance, you know, you can't touch it without wuzu. And so there are many, many issues there. And in order to get, you know, away from it, you know, the Muslims in South Asia use this numerical system from the Arabs for writing Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim in a code word. This is also used by the poets quite a lot. You know, among the poets, one of the traditions is that when they talk about a great personality, about their birth, or their, when they die, they have a eulogy for them. And in that sha'iri at the end, they will mention something about this fellow where the description of that person, if you look at the numerical values of those alphabets, you get the birth, the year of the death of that person. In many, many masajid, you will see they have two lines, poetry, about that masjid. If you really look at it carefully, you will see it will give you the year in which that masjid was built. Those days, you didn't have, you know, Department of Statistics. There was no mandatory law, for example, when your child is born, you must go and register the child. So this was also used as a mechanism to preserve the birthdays of the individuals. You know, in the South Asian culture, especially among those who were, you know, I would say more learned and literate, they would even choose the name of their children where the meaning would be good, and even the numerical value of the alphabets of the name will be the year of the birth. And I can give you an example from my own family. Many of you know my father, my late father. His name was, if we see the slide number 3 there, his name was, you know him as Sayyid Saeed Akhtar Rizvi, or Razavi. Sayyid and Rizvi, the family name, which goes with all generations before and after. His proper name was Saeed Akhtar. It's a beautiful name, and it means the fortunate star. That's the meaning. And alhamdulillah, you know, Allah made him a you know, fortunate star of the Shia world among the ulama. But if you look at the numerical value of the alphabets in Saeed Akhtar, Sin, Ain, Ye, Dal, Alif, Kha, Te, and Ra, you will get the number 1345, which is the Hijra year of the birth of my father. So this was common among the literary families, that because those days you didn't have, you know, to go and register the child's name or birth year. They had to write it somewhere in their favorite Quran or a dua book. You know, sometimes you look at the old books, you will see that, you know, the person would have written their children's birth date and things like that. This was one way. And that required talent. It's not only, you know, you figure put the alphabets together. No, even the meaning has to be good. And the numbers have to be according to the birth. And so this is one, you know, way it's used. Let me end with a very interesting play with the numerical values. During the Safavid era, you know, the Safavi kings were the one who declared Shia Mazhab in Iran to be the official Mazhab. And there is no doubt that it was because of their influence and their resources that they put in place that the Shia Mazhab spread in the Iranian country. Before that, it was majority a Sunni land. So we are just talking about 450 years ago. Before that, you know, Iran was a Sunni country. Many of the prominent Sunni ulama, everyone from where you talk about Bukhari, Abu Hanifa, Tabari, Fakhruddin Razi, all of them were Iranians. You know, but it was Safavid influence, which didn't force, but brought about the environment where Shia Mazhab could be propagated in that land. And so one of the kings, the early days, by the name of Shah Tahmasp, in his coronation, many prominent scholars from both Mawahib had been invited. And there was a Sunni alim. If we see the last slide, just the early part of it. The beginning of the Safavid rule in Iran was year 906 of the Hijra calendar. A Sunni alim who was very well versed with numbers and Farsi and Arabic literature just made a taunt there. He said, you know, this year 906, if I look for a expression which has the same numerical value, it comes to the statement in Farsi, mazhabe na haq. Mazhabe na haq, which means untrue mazhab. So he was taunting that the beginning of this Safavid era was year 906. And when I look at the words mazhabe na haq, the untrue mazhab, the numerical value of the alphabets in this statement is same, 906. There was another Shia alim, equally talented in that. He gave a, you know, extempore answer. This is where you have to know. You have to know the mathematics as well as the language. He said, Shaykhana, you are mistaken. The language of our religion is Arabic, not Farsi. Without changing a single alphabet, he said, if you look at that phrase again, it's not mazhabe ha na haq in Farsi, it's mazhabuna haqqun. Our mazhab is true. So just by twisting it from Farsi to Arabic, he said, you know, you're mistaken. You know, Farsi is not the language of our deen. You know, if you look at it in Arabic, same alphabets. But he just moved it around there. Mazhabuna haqqun. Our mazhab is haq and the truth. You know, so these things, of course, they are not shari that much. But sometimes when you see some of the cultural innovations or bid'ah, do not just, you know, put it down right away. These are some of the things that we probably, if we can maintain, these are good things in those Muslim cultures where they have still maintained that. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين.